Recorded Books and RB Digital present The Wind in His Heart by Charles de Lint, narrated by Tom Stechschulte. Nearly everything that matters is a challenge, and everything matters. Rilke. Some things have to be believed to be seen. Madeline L'Engle. I am going over yonder where no ghost can follow me. There's another place beyond here where I'll be free, I believe. Steve Earle, Over Yonder, Jonathan's Song. The Throwaway Child. Chapter 1. Thomas Corneyes. Those days, the prickly pear boys hung around the little tree trading post during the day, drowsing in the desert heat mostly, but still seeing and hearing everything that took place between the old adobe building and the two-lane road that ran up into the res from the highway. They weren't seen themselves, or at least not as themselves. Nobody gave a second glance to the small grove of cacti crowded up against the base of one saguaro or another. Nobody even noticed that they were rarely in exactly the same place from one morning to the next. But Thomas Corneyes did. He worked at the trading post and noticed their different position every morning when he arrived for work. No one in Thomas's family had ever had eyes the color of corn, either the green leaves of the tall midsummer growths or the yellow of the kernels. They got their name back when the federal government insisted a surname was required for everybody, without exception. On the res, they had a lot of fun coming up with names the whites thought were pregnant with traditional meaning. Johnny Squash Mother, Agnes White Deer, Robert Twin Dogs. No, Thomas had brown eyes, the same as everyone else in the tribe. The difference was, he could also see a little deeper into the invisible world of the spirits than most people could. But that wasn't something he would ever talk about. He didn't want to risk gaining the attention of the tribal shaman, Ramon Morago. For the past decade, Morago had been searching for an apprentice, and working with him was the last thing Thomas wanted. It wasn't that he was ashamed of his Kikemi heritage, or even that he didn't consider himself a spiritual person, but he was only 18, and he didn't want to spend the rest of his life living on the res, organizing sweats. He didn't want to be making medicine bags for the aunties, taking Reuben's dog boys out on their spirit quests, or any of the 101 other things a shaman did. But no matter what he wanted or didn't, he still saw into the spirit world, and the spirits knew it. Thomas was studying the cacti through the windows, trying to catch one of the prickly pear moving, when the long black caddy pulled into the parking lot. It was a 56 or 57, a real classic, and in perfect shape. The glossy black paint job so deep it seemed to swallow light. He couldn't see a speck of dust on it, which, considering the roads around here, had to be a bit of a miracle. The tinted windows didn't let him see the driver, but man, you'd have to feel like the king of the world behind the wheel of a car like that. He straightened up behind the counter when the driver's door opened, and a striking older woman stepped out. He wasn't sure what made him think she was older. Her features were youthful, and she moved with the easy grace of a dancer. She was tall and colt thin, with a wave of thick black hair that was almost as glossy as the car's paint job. He figured her for a model, maybe even an actress. But neither explained what she was doing, driving herself out here in the sticks, except that she looked native. Not Kikemi, but definitely Indian. Then he caught a glimpse of her aura. The ghostly shape of a raven's head on her shoulders, and he figured she was going into the res to meet with Morago or the aunts. She glanced in the direction of the trading post and caught him staring. Thomas looked away, but not before he saw her smile. So much for maintaining his cool. When she came inside, She should have seemed out of place in her tight designer jeans, strapped sandals, and the midriff-bearing t-shirt that probably cost more than everything he had in his closet put together. Her skin was the hue of the shadows in a red rock canyon, and her eyes so dark they seemed all pupil. The eyes, he decided, were what made him think she was older. The trading post was like an old general store, the shelves stuffed with everything from groceries and toiletries to clothing and tools, with a cast-iron stove up against one adobe wall, around which Reuben's friends would sit in the afternoon to gossip and drink coffee or tea. But oddly enough, the woman appeared to fit her present surroundings as comfortably as she might a runway or some fancy restaurant. Odder still, her raven aura didn't rest passively on her shoulders. It looked around the trading post as though it had a mind of its own. He'd never seen anything like that before. He wasn't a stranger to the auras themselves. His awareness of them was an element of his being able to see into the spirit world. Not everybody had an aura. It was only those with the closest ties to their Ma'inawa blood, those who carried an animal spirit as well as a human one inside them. But he'd never seen an aura that acted independently the way this one did. "Hola," he said. "Welcome to the Painted Lands." The woman smiled and pointed to the cooler at the far end of the counter. "Do you have any bottled Coke in there?" "Yes, ma'am." His response seemed to amuse her, and Thomas felt a flush creep up from under his shirt collar. To cover his embarrassment, he went over to the cooler. He took a bottle out of the icy water, wiped it down with a terry cloth towel, and popped the cap. Returning to his place behind the counter, he set it down in front of her. "How much?" she asked. "$1. Her perfectly shaped eyebrows went up. Thomas shrugged. "People around here don't have a lot of money. Reuben, my boss, doesn't like to gouge them." She pulled a $20 bill out of the front pocket of her jeans and handed it to him. Thomas didn't think there'd been room for even a bill in that pocket. "Keep the change," she said. "Do I really look like that much of a charity case?" Thomas thought. But he only nodded and put the money in the till. A woman like her, she could afford to help out Reuben's bottom line. "And how much for a map?" she asked. "Of the res or the national park?" "I'm going to the casino." Of course she was. "You're on the wrong side of the res," he told her. "There's a right and a wrong side?" "No, though I guess that might depend on who you're talking to. What I mean is, this isn't the fancy side with the casino. That's south of here, on the other side of the Vulture Ridge trailhead." "The what?" "That's just the part of the national park that divides the two sides of the res. All you need to do is keep going south when you get to the trailhead. There's plenty of signs, so you don't need a map." He gave her directions that would take her back down Jacinta to Zara Road, where a south turn would take her straight to the casino. She barely seemed to be paying attention, but her raven aura fixed him with an unwavering gaze as he spoke. It was as if it was more than simply an aura and was memorizing his words for her as well as itself. Thomas focused on the woman's face, trying to ignore the ghostly presence of the bird. "Just remember," he said, "that Zara changes names at the crossroads and becomes Redondo Drive when it continues south."
"I will. Thank you."
He watched her start for the door, the head of the raven aura revolving so it continued to face him. She paused just before stepping outside and turned back to look at him.
"You've been so helpful," she said, "that I feel I should share some direction with you."
Thomas had no idea what she was talking about.
That's okay, he said. "I'm pretty sure I know where I am."
"Are you?"
Thomas shrugged.
"I've lived here all my life."
"But do you know who you are?"
she asked.
The raven aura cocked its head when she spoke. Thomas had really never seen anything like it before. He'd never seen a woman like the one at the door, either. She could as easily have stepped right out of the pages of a magazine or from a movie screen as from that long black caddy she was driving. "I don't really think it matters who I am," he said. "That might be the saddest thing I've heard all day," she told him. That was because she didn't live on this side of the res, he thought. But all he did was give her another shrug. "It should matter to you," she added. "You should learn about yourself. Embrace all the aspects of who you are." Thomas couldn't stop himself. Says the woman in designer clothes on the way to the casino in a vintage Cadillac. Her dark gaze held his for a long moment. "Not everything is what it appears to be on the surface," she said. Then the door was closing behind her. He tracked her through the window as she returned to her car. She never looked back, but the raven aura watched him until the closing car door cut them both from view. Well, that wasn't weird. He stood looking out the window long after the dust kicked up by her tires had settled. Chapter 2. Steve Cole. I'm camped on a ridge overlooking Zara Road, the highway that follows the foothills of the Hierro Maderas Mountains, when I hear the car. It's been a perfect night. Crisp, cool air, with a moon close enough to full that it casts long shadows on the desert floor below. It's the kind of night where you can imagine you're the only person in the world. It's just you and the desert. Sure, there are coyotes talking from time to time off in the distance, an owl hooting from the top of a saguaro this past hour or so, mice scurrying about in the brush closer to hand. But no people, no hikers, nobody joyriding on their ATVs, not even any kikimi whose land this is. Until the car. The stars tell me it's not yet midnight. I step over to where the ground drops off and watch the headlights as they come down the otherwise deserted two-lane blacktop below. A few hundred yards past my camp, the car pulls over. The passenger door opens, and a figure stumbles out onto the packed dirt on the side of the road. I make it to be a woman or a girl, with a head of hair, though I've known my share of long-haired guys, but she doesn't move like a guy. Once she gets her balance, she lunges back toward the car, but the door slams shut. The driver stomps on the gas, spitting gravel. The figure runs a little ways after the car, only stopping when she sees she doesn't have a hope in hell of catching up. She stands there for a long moment, shoulders drooping, arms hanging at her sides in defeat. Then she sinks to the ground and sits there, hugging her knees. The coyotes howl again, closer than the last time I heard them. I'm not worried, but the woman below jerks her head. Coyote attacks are rare. She doesn't know that. Or maybe she's smart to be nervous, because, bottom line, you can't trust anything you meet out here in the desert. Not the thorns, the heat, the mountains, the animals, the people. Most especially, not the people. Possum Jones, the old desert rat who took me under his wing way back in the 80s, told me his number one rule was, don't get involved. You see somebody, best walk in the other direction. Most times, he said in that drawl of his, you'll get more sympathy from a hungry mountain lion. Of course, this was while he was setting my broken leg after he found me at the bottom of a canyon. So I took what he had to say with a grain of salt. Until that moment, we'd never met. But the fact of the matter is, up in the mountains, out in the desert, most times, he's right. That girl down there, she could be in trouble, or could be she had a little spat with her boyfriend and he's already on his way back.
He catches me with his girl. He could pull out a 12-gauge and teach me the difference between buckshot and gut shot. Let me give you a hint. The first causes the pain. The second is the pain. God damn, I mutter as I turn back to my camp. I pack up my gear and throw dirt on the fire, then make my way down to the highway. It's a roundabout route, so it takes me a good 15 minutes before I'm standing on the blacktop. I'm a quarter of a mile south of the woman. I don't know which I'm hoping for more, that she'll be there or she'll be gone. But when the highway takes me around the headland, I see the small figure, still huddled on the side of the road. I start to whistle an old cowboy tune as I get closer to give her some warning. The first few bars of Streets of Laredo work just fine. Her head lifts like it did when the coyotes called, but she doesn't do anything more than look over her shoulder in my direction. I sigh. She's just a kid. I doubt she's even 16, and too damn trusting. Meeting a stranger out here, she should have been smart and taken to the scrub till she could figure out what's up. I'm at least 3 times her age and 2x her size. But all she does is sit there, still hugging her knees, watching me come. I stop 10 feet away, lower my pack to the dirt, and hunch down to reduce the appearance of my size, resting my weight on my ankles. She's wearing jeans and a hoodie, sneakers with no socks. She looks cold, and I don't blame her. Once the sun goes down in the mountains, the temperature drops with it. I'm wearing a sweater under my jean jacket, and I can still feel the chill in the air. "Hey," I say. She just looks at me. I dig a bottle of water from my pack and offer it to her. "You thirsty? Fuck off." "Nice." "Your mama kissed that mouth of yours?" I ask. "The only part of her that ever touched my mouth is the back of her hand." "Okay." "Was that her who pushed you out of the car?"
"What are you, stalking me?"
"I was camped up there." I jerk a thumb up to the top of the ridge. "It's more like you brought your drama into my living room."
"You live out here, most of the time."
She scoots around so that she's no longer looking at me over her shoulder. "What do you do?" she asks. "Commune with nature."
"I bet you run drugs. You got any weed in your bag? Maybe some uppers?"
I sigh, but I don't answer. "Who pushed you out of the car?"
"Why do you care?"
"I want to be charitable, I really do, but I've never had the patience for this kind of crap." "Not so much, I guess," I say and stand up. "Not enough to have to work at it, that's for damn sure. I'll leave you the water. You'll need it when the sun comes up. You have yourself a good day."
"Hey," she calls when I start to walk away. "You can't just leave me here."
"Watch me," I reply without turning.
"It was my dad, okay? That's who dumped me here."
This time I stop and turn to look back at her. She's standing up, hands stuffed deep into the pockets of her hoodie, a challenging look in her eyes. I have no idea how to respond. "Jesus," I finally say. "Why would he do that?"
"To make room for a new foster kid."
"So he's your foster father," she shakes her head.
"But he gets money for each foster kid they take in. He's up to 3 now, but if he gets rid of me, there's room for 1 more."
"This is why I live in the mountains and desert. They insulate you from the crap people do to each other." "Seems to me you got 3 choices," I tell her. I count them off on my fingers. "You can wait here. Come morning, you might be able to hitch a ride to wherever you need to go. Or you can come back to my camp and wait while I go find somebody that can help you. Or you can take the hike with me."
"Why don't you just call somebody?" she asks.
"Don't have a phone." She gives me a look.
"Everybody's got a phone."
"Okay, so where's yours?"
"I use Reggie's, and seeing how things played out today, I guess I won't be borrowing it again. And he's my loser dad.
Everywhere this conversation goes, it takes me to a story I don't want to hear.
Three choices, I tell her. Which is it going to be?
Can we go to your camp and take the hike in the morning? I don't want to go walking into a cactus.
There's still hours before the moon sets, but I guess she's a city kid and doesn't see the way I can out here. Hell, I can make my way through this land in the dark of the moon.
Sure, we can do that.
20 minutes later, we're back on the bluff from which I first spotted her. I get the fire started again, and she sits up close to it, my spare blanket wrapped around her shoulders, while she stares into the flames. I boil some water and make tea.
Here, I tell her as I hand her a tin mug. Sorry, I don't have sugar or milk.
It's okay.
You hungry?
She shakes her head. I settle across the fire from her.
I'm Steve. What's your name?
Sadie.
Huh.
She looks up, that challenge back in her eyes. I know it's a loser name. I didn't pick it.
It's not that.
My grandmother's name was Sadie.
I guess she sees something in my face because she asks,
what happened to her?
She got the death penalty for killing her husband. This was back in Texas where the family's from. She might have gotten off or only had to serve some time, but instead of shooting him when he was hitting her, she waited until he was drunk and asleep and then shot him in the face.
She doesn't say anything for a long moment, and I wonder what the hell made me tell her that. I walked the desert with Possum Jones for 20 years, and it never came up once.
Her head lifts, and she looks at me from across the fire. The firelight makes the glint in her eyes look fierce.
I can relate to that, she says.
I like to believe that we can be better than that myself, I tell her. But honestly, knowing what a piece of work my grandfather was, I can relate to it too. I still miss her.
Must be nice having family you can miss.
So you've got nobody else you can stay with, friends, kin? She shakes her head.
Reggie didn't like us making friends outside the house.
Sounds like Reggie's a real piece of work.
She shrugs and takes a sip of her tea, pulling a face at the bitter taste.
So, what do you want to do? I ask.
She gives me a puzzled look.
With your life, I say. Where do you want to go? What do you want to do with your life?
I don't know.
I don't want to go anywhere. There's no place to go anyway.
What did you think was going to happen when you came up here to my camp?
I thought maybe you'd fuck me and then give me some money.
What?
Except I guess you don't think I'm pretty enough.
I shake my head.
You've got this all wrong.
You wouldn't have to look at my face while you're doing it.
For Christ's sake. You could be my granddaughter, but it's never going to happen, kid.
Confusion returns to her face.
Reggie says old guys all like to fuck young girls.
Yeah, well, Reggie needs his face rearranged.
That's not all he needs rearranged. He can't get it up anymore, and that pisses him off.
Listen, kid, you shouldn't even know that shit.
She shrugs.
It's just what it is. So what? Jesus.
You're young, and you've got your whole life ahead of you. Focus on getting an education. Make something of yourself. You ever hear the expression, success is the best revenge?
She shakes her head.
You make something of yourself, and that just shows losers like Reggie you're better than them.
But I'm not. Don't say that, I tell her.
She fiddles with the cuffs of the hoodie, pulls them down over her knuckles. She won't look at me.
I wouldn't even know where to start, she says.
I know people who can help you.
Why would they?
Because it's what they do.
You should get some rest. It's a bit of a hike in the morning.
She nods.
You don't sound much like a Texan, she says.
How would you know what we sound like?
You think I've never seen a movie or a TV show? They all talk funny. Maybe when I left home I made a point of learning to talk like a Yankee.
Why would you do that?
She asked. I shrugged. Kids get embarrassed about the stupidest things. If I had to do it over, I wouldn't. But now this is just the way I talk. The only time you'll hear me drawl these days is when I'm putting it on.
Why would you want to do that?
Why don't you get yourself some rest? She has another sip of her tea and grimaces again before she sets it down in the sand by the fire.
You need to get some normal tea, she says as she lies down. That tastes like a dog pissed in it.
Good night to you too, I tell her. I finish my own tea. It's not my best batch, but it beats buying it from a store. I wait until her breathing evens out, then stand up and stretch. I walk away from the camp and take a leak. When I get back, Calico's sitting on a rock, a big grin on her face. I don't know why she's attached herself to me, but it's not like I got any choice in the matter. She just showed up a few years ago, not long after Possum died, and has been hanging around ever since, not that I mind. Her smarts and beauty are off the chart.
Didn't think I'd see you tonight, I say. I thought you said you were off leading the dog boys on a chase.
She shrugs. I took them up through Devil's Canyon and wore them right out. Those boys are not in good shape. She nods to the sleeping girl.
Didn't take you for the nurturing type.
I'm not.
But she needs help.
Yeah, I overheard. I was feeling horny before I got here, but listening to her story pretty much put a damper on that.
That's Calico in a nutshell, full of innuendo and mischief. I'm taking her to Morago, see if he can help.
But she's not kicking me.
Neither is the money they got for their center.
Calico cocks her head. Except I thought it came to them with no strings attached.
It did. Same as Sadie's coming to them. They can help or not, but I'm hoping they'll help. It's pretty damn obvious her own people are useless.
She nods. Call me if you decide to go break this Reggie's head, but remember, it's not the Wild West anymore. They come after you for stuff like that now. Doesn't matter how justified.
Call you? I say with a laugh. How am I supposed to do that? Neither of us even has a... But she's already gone.
Who was that woman that came by last night?
Sadie asked me in the morning. I'm in the middle of pouring myself a second cup of coffee and almost dropped the pot.
You saw her?
Well, yeah. Was I not supposed to?
You could have told me you already have a girlfriend.
I stopped mid-pour.
I was sure the kid was dead asleep. It's a good thing Calico and I didn't get into anything amorous.
You really saw her?
I repeat.
Have you been into the weed? That's what I just said. And what's with the furry deal? Is that your kink?
I don't know what to say. My girlfriend's a, for lack of a better term, foxalope. Part antelope, part fox. You should see the look on Calico's face when I use the word. She looks to be in her mid-30s with a shock of fox-red hair that she usually wears loose and a pair of small antelope horns that push up from the top of her brow. Some days, she's also got fox ears and a big bushy tail. She calls herself a Ma'inawa, which is Kikemi for cousin. We keep our relationship on the down low, so this is weird, and I don't know how to explain it.
Furry? I manage.
That's a thing? She nods.
Yeah, you know. People who put on costumes pretending they're some kind of animal. It's how they get it up.
Sure, I say.
Let's go with that. And that's what turns you on?
No, she's... Look, we should get going. I turn away and start packing my gear, covering the fire.
God, I hope I never grow old, she says. If you've got a kink, so what?
own it? I don't bother answering.
3 hours later, a gaggle of Rez dogs welcomes us to Abigail Whitehorse's yard. They run circles around us, barking, tails wagging. Sadie shrinks away from them and moves closer to me. It's okay, I tell her. They're friendly. Yeah, tell that to the last guy they ate. Aggie's place is high up in the foothills, at the end of a couple of miles of winding dirt road. It's a long, low adobe building with a lean-to and corral made of saguaro ribs on the south. A pair of those big cacti dominate one side of the yard, with a stand of raggedy mesquite and palo verde on the other. There's the remains of a fire pit out past the corral. Farther up the hill is a little adobe casita that serves as the old woman's studio. She comes out of the little building now, drawn by the dog's welcome. Someone once told me she's got to be in her 80s or more, but she looks more like she's in her late 60s. Out hiking, she's got staying power long past anything I can muster, and I can jog for a couple of hours under the hot summer sun. She's sturdily built, with an open brown face and gray-white hair pulled back into a long braid.
"I thought you were Old Man Puma," she says, "coming down off the mountain the way you did. Pretty sure you gave the dogs a heart attack."
We are up on the ridge trail. She nods. Her gaze shifts to Sadie.
"Who's your friend?" she asks.
Says her name is Sadie. I found her up north on Zara Road.
Found her? Was there a wreck?
I shake my head. She got tossed from a car. Aggie frowns. It wasn't moving, I add.
And that makes it better?
I didn't say that. She focuses her attention back to Sadie.
How are you holding up, child?
She asks. Sadie fiddles with the cuffs of her hoodie and shrugs.
I'm fine, she says.
Aggie studies her until the girl finally looks up. Sadie shifts from foot to foot, but she doesn't look away. Aggie has that effect on people.
So you're looking for a safe place for her? Aggie asks me.
I nod. Whoa, Sadie says. I'm not staying out here in the middle of nowhere. It'll just be for a day or so, I tell her. I need to talk to this guy named Ramon Morago. Figure out a few legalities, but you should be able to move to the dorm in a few days.
What dorm?
You want to finish high school, right? We talked about it on the way here.
We didn't talk about no dorm. I want to go with you and live in the desert.
I shake my head.
Don't worry, she says. I won't cramp your style with your furry girlfriend.
Girlfriend? Aggie says, her brows rising.
Yeah, Sadie says helpfully.
The one with the furry fetish. Forget it, I tell her. But Aggie isn't about to let it go.
What does that mean? She asks Sadie. What's a furry fetish?
You know, she likes to dress up and pretend she's an animal. Big fox tail and ears, little deer horns. Aggie's lip twitches.
And how long has this been going on? She asks me.
I sigh. I like my privacy and don't want to talk about the relationship, especially in front of a kid. But Aggie's waiting for an answer. She showed up after Possum died.
Possum? Sadie says. Are all your friends into this animal thing?
No, I tell her. It's just his name. I don't know how he got it. He never told me, and I never asked.
John Littletree gave it to him, Aggie says, back in the day. Because he was playing dead back then.
I don't get it, I say. She shrugs.
He lived in the desert while the rest of the world thought he was dead.
Now it's my gaze she holds. I know what those dark eyes of hers are saying. We might as well call you Possum, too.
So it was like his Indian name, Sadie says.
Aggie nods, her gaze still holding mine.
And what's the name of your friend? She asks.
Calico.
I know her. I'd say be careful. Fox girls are tricksters, but antelope are loyal, so you're probably okay.
Sadie's following our exchange with big eyes.
She visits you? I ask.
Aggie shrugs. Cousins. They stop around from time to time.
So you know Calico. Does anyone else?
Ask Reuben Littletree about her visits. She seems to have made it her life's work to tease him and those dog boys of his.
I pinch the bridge of my nose, trying to make sense of what she's saying. Calico does have a thing about running dogs, but this business about Reuben is giving me a headache.
When you say dog boys, Sadie asks Aggie, are they really part dog?
No, I say, eyeing the kid.
Yes,
Aggie says at the same time. I sigh, but Sadie doesn't seem to have any problem with it. That's clear from the bright interest in her eyes.
I'd like to stay here, she says to Aggie, if it's still okay. Of course, Aggie says. I'll get a poultice for those injuries of yours.
Sadie's eyes go big. Me, I'm in the dark. What injuries? I ask. Neither of them responds for a long moment. Then Sadie pulls down the zipper of her hoodie and takes it off. She drops it in the dirt and stands there in a sleeveless t-shirt. Her forearms are covered with dozens of tiny scars and cuts that cross each other in a bewildering pattern. They look like they were made with a razor or a really sharp knife. Some look infected. Then she lifts the t-shirt up to the bottom of her breasts. Her whole torso is a mess of bruises, yellow and green, purple and blue. The fuck? Pops out of my mouth. My hands are clenched and fists at my side. Who did that to you? But I already know.
He only hits me where it doesn't show, she says.
And did he cut you, too? When she doesn't answer, I realize she did it to herself.
Maybe, Aggie says, it's a way to take back ownership of your body.
Sadie shakes her head.
It's okay, Aggie says. You don't have to talk about it. And you can stay here as long as you need to.
She nods and picks up her hoodie, but she doesn't put it on. I can't take my gaze from all those crisscrossing cuts on her arms. Why the hell would anybody do that to themselves?
You go on ahead inside and make yourself comfortable, Aggie says. I'll be right in.
She nods again, but she doesn't move.
Is there something else you need to tell us?
Aggie asks. She looks at me.
You're not going after him, are you?
Who, Reggie?
Yeah.
Why would you want to protect him?
I don't, she says. But I don't want you to get into trouble, and I don't want him taking anything out on the foster kids. You've got a good heart, Aggie says.
Do I? Sadie asks. Then why's my life such crap? Aggie shakes her head.
We'll see what we can do to make it better.
Sadie turns her attention back to me. Am I going to see you again?
Sure.
I come by here all the time. She doesn't say anything else, but she keeps looking at me, waiting.
Okay, I say. Reggie's off limits for now. I can't promise forever.
She mouths the word, thanks, and walks toward the house. One of the dogs steps close to her and bumps its head against her leg. I expect Sadie to freak, but she just drops a hand and absently strokes Ruby's head. It's like Aggie's words change something inside her, and she's no longer afraid of the dogs. She goes inside the house, the dog with her, and the door closes behind them. I turn to Aggie.
Calico and I, we've been keeping this private.
So I see. I thought you were alone most of the time out there by choice.
I am, just not always. But solitude doesn't bother me in crap like Sadie's life. That's why I'm done with the world beyond these mountains. I'm not running away from anything. I just don't like the way people live their lives out there.
I understand, Aggie says. But when it comes to the world right here, maybe it's time you realized some of the other people you meet out in these hills aren't necessarily human.
Like who?
That doesn't matter right now. What matters is that you keep your heart open. Speaking of which, why did you help the girl? Why didn't you just walk away?
A lot of things go running through my mind. The way Sadie was just sitting there on the side of the road, arms wrapped around her knees. Possum shooting a coyote caught in a trap, the festering of its infected forepaw having already crawled up into its torso, swelling its chest to twice its normal size. Reuben catching pack rats nesting around the kids' dormitory and taking them clear across the mountain before letting them go, whereas somebody else would have just shot them. The hell would I know, I finally say. I'm going to talk to Morago. I head off before she can ask me something else I can't answer. Chapter 3. Sadie Higgins. Sadie didn't know what to expect inside the old woman's house. If she was lucky, maybe she could find something she could pocket and pawn if she ever made it back to town. But it didn't look like she'd find much in here. The back door she came through led her into a large, open concept space sparsely furnished with chunky wooden furniture that looked handmade. There were patterned rugs everywhere, on the floor, hanging on the walls, draped over the back of the couch. They were like the kind you'd see in the Indian market on Mission Street, except these ones were all old and faded. Everything here seemed old and faded, and a little weird. There was what looked like a whole field of dried plants hanging in bundles from the rafters of the kitchen area. Who did that? There weren't any normal glasses or plates. Except for finely woven baskets, everything seemed to be made of pottery. And then there were all the paintings hanging on the walls, perched on surfaces or on the floor leaning against the walls. They reminded Sadie of the woman who had visited Steve at the camp last night. Like her, all the people in them had animal and plant parts. A man with a coyote's head, a stand of prickly pear with 100 little faces, a rabbit with human arms, an owl with a woman's face, see-through saguaro with people sleeping inside them. The figures were stylized, but at the same time appeared too realistic for her comfort. There was something creepy about them. She wanted to ignore them, but she couldn't seem to look away either. The background colors seemed all off as well. Brown skies and blue desert floor, purple and pink mesas with yellow and blue cacti. They made the figures pop out, but that only made their own oddities harder to ignore. After she'd walked around and looked at all the paintings on the walls, she started going through the ones on the floor. They were 3 to 4 deep in places. She didn't know why she was doing it. She didn't even want to look at all these strange creatures in the first place. Finally, she came across a couple of stacks of portraits of ordinary people. They were still a little creepy, just because of the way Aggie painted, she supposed, but at least they were normal. She figured they were folks who lived on the res. She didn't know any of them. Then she stopped. There was Steve. Sadie sat back on her heels and studied this one, because she knew what he actually looked like. This was the first time she could appreciate that maybe the old lady wasn't a complete loser. The figure in the painting didn't only look like Steve, it felt like him, too. And it didn't creep her out as much as the animal people did. After a few moments, she let the other paintings in the stack fall back in front and got up to finish looking around. The red dog that followed her inside had dropped to the floor and stretched out as they came in. Its eyes followed Sadie as she roamed around the room. The only modern convenience she could spot was a laptop computer on a table in one corner. Even the phone was an old black rotary model. She lifted the receiver and listened to the dial tone for a moment before she laid it back in its cradle. There was no one she could call, nobody who'd want to hear from her except for maybe Alyssa, the oldest of the foster kids her parents had taken in. But she couldn't call her because, just like Sadie herself, Alyssa didn't have her own phone. The only people allowed to answer the phone were Reggie and her mother, Tina. The dog lifted its head, and Sadie turned to see Aggie come in. The old woman was interesting, but she was kind of creepy weird, too, just like her house. How had Aggie known she was a cutter? "Did you do these paintings?" she asked. Aggie nodded. "And people buy them?" Aggie smiled. "Not to your taste?" Sadie realized she'd better dial it back. She didn't want to offend the old lady and get thrown out on her ass. "I've just never seen anything like them before," she said. "You're not alone," Aggie told her. "They make other people uncomfortable, too. But it doesn't matter one way or the other. They're not for sale. Each one is a little piece of the subject rendered in the portrait. And how could one sell pieces of one's friends?" Sadie remembered the conversation outside. "So these are, like, people you know and they look like this?"
"When they wish to," Aggie said.
"And they're not wearing costumes?"
"No." "Now, come sit here," Aggie said,
motioning toward a chair at the kitchen table.
"I want to look at those cuts. Stretch your arms out on the table."
Sadie hesitated, suddenly feeling embarrassed and shy.
"I don't make judgments," the old lady said. "I don't agree with what you're doing to yourself, but only you can decide whether to keep on doing it or to stop."
Sadie put her hands in the pockets of her jeans. Her fingers closed around the handle of the little utility knife she carried everywhere.
"I can't seem to stop," she found herself admitting. "Maybe it will become easier now that you're away from the bad situation you were in, and if you concentrate on something else."
"You mean like schoolwork?"
"Or whatever else you can find to distract you."
"A joint would seriously help, except for that," the old woman said. Of course she'd think that, Sadie thought. God, old people.
"I'm not so sure about this whole going back to high school deal," she said.
"I only agreed so Steve would shut up. The whole morning he kept going on about how things were different back in his day, how a kid didn't have to finish high school, but they could still get a decent job and do well. But now even a degree doesn't promise anybody anything. But without it, you've got nothing."
Aggie went to the long table by the sink while Sadie sat down. "Did you promise Steve you'd do it?" Aggie asked.
"No, I just said I'd think about it."
"Good."
"Good what? That I'll think about it or that I didn't promise him?"
"Both, really. It's important to be an honorable person. The oppressors can take everything else away from us, our freedom, our hope, our dignity, but they can't take our honor. So when you give your word, be sure you keep it, and make sure you only promise what you can deliver."
"What's that supposed to mean?" Aggie regarded her for a long moment.
"Let's say your best friend is dying of cancer. You could say to her that you promise she'll get better, but you both know that's not a promise you can keep. But if you say that you promise to stay with her until the very end, that has meaning. It lets them know they won't die alone. And that means more than any empty promise."
"Okay. I kind of see that."
"Good,"
Aggie fussed with a few things at the long table where she stood, then finally brought back a clay bowl filled with some kind of thick green-brown paste.
"What's that?"
Sadie asked, grimacing.
"Medicine. It'll fight the infection and itchiness, and help the cuts and bruises to heal more quickly. It'll sting a bit when it's first applied, but you should find some immediate relief. Try to think of something else while I put it on."
How is she supposed to do that? Sadie wondered. All she could do was anticipate the coming pain. She winced when the old woman began to spread the paste on her cuts.
"Talk to me," Aggie said. "Don't think about this."
"Okay, but crap, that really stung." Sadie had to blink back tears. She tried to think of something to say. "So, Steve's girlfriend," she finally said, "she's not wearing a costume either?" Aggie shook her head.
"Weird.
I guess he's got a kink or something.
Or maybe he doesn't see the difference."
"What's that supposed to mean?"
"Steve's one of those people who sees a person for what they are inside, not what they show to the world."
Sadie shivered. "God. He must think I'm a total freak. No wonder he didn't want to sleep with me."
"I think that has more to do with your age and that you were in a vulnerable position when he found you."
Sadie didn't get that. "So, what's his deal, anyway?" she asked the old woman. "Does he really just live out in the desert?" Aggie nodded.
"Has for probably 30-40 years now."
"What's he running from?"
"You'll have to ask him."
"You don't have a guess?"
"I don't go poking into other people's stories. It's not polite."
"I'm just curious," Sadie said. "I don't mean anything by it."
"I know. And there we are. All done."
Sadie realized she'd completely forgotten what the old woman was doing. And she'd been right. The itchiness was completely gone. And so was the pain.
"If you feel chilled," Aggie said, "go out and sit in the sun. We should try to keep your hoodie from chafing against the skin until the medicine has done its work. You can rinse it off in an hour or so."
"Okay. Thanks.
Now, I want to go back to the piece I'm working on. Will you be okay here on your own?"
"Trusting much?" Sadie thought. But she just nodded until she figured a few things out. She had nowhere else to go.
"Are you hungry or thirsty? I should have asked you sooner."
"Nah, Steve gave me all kinds of crap from that backpack of his. The thing must weigh a ton."
"He's a strong man, in more ways than one."
"I guess," Sadie said. Then she had a thought. "Is it okay if I use your computer?"
"Go ahead. It's on dial-up, so it'll probably seem like it runs on molasses compared to what you had at home."
"Reggie doesn't let anybody use his computer except for him. I use the ones at school or the library." Aggie gave her a look Sadie didn't recognize. She thought maybe Aggie felt sorry for her, but there was no way for her to tell. Nobody had ever felt sorry for her before, not even her teachers. The school was so rough they all looked exhausted most of the time. Aggie started to reach out a hand to her, then seemed to reconsider and let it fall to her side.
"Well, you can use this one as much as you like," was all she said. "Make yourself at home," she added. Then she stepped out the back door, and Sadie was alone again in the old woman's house.
Except for the dog. Ruby, Steve said her name was.
"So are you a real dog?" Sadie asked. "Or are you like the guys in the paintings?"
Ruby looked at her, but didn't even bother to lift her head. Sadie walked over to the computer.
She wondered how far it was to civilization. Maybe she could take off, sell the computer to somebody for a quick few bucks. Ah, who was she kidding?
Even if she got back to the city, she had nowhere to go. She was stuck out here in the middle of the sticks until she could figure out more than just running away. Because the problem with running was, you needed to have somewhere to run to. All she knew for sure was she wouldn't be going home again. Who knew where the hell Reggie would dump her the next time? She sat down and opened the computer. Once it woke up, she called up a browser. Yeah, she was stuck here, but until she came up with a way out, she could at least find out who Steve really was and why he was hiding out in the mountains. She knew just where to start. She typed a string of words into the browser's search bar. Sadie, Texas, death penalty. Chapter 4, Thomas. Working at Little Tree Trading Post, there was no way Thomas would ever be able to save enough money to get away from the res. His boss, Reuben Littletree, couldn't afford to pay much, but the little Thomas did earn had to cover living expenses for the whole Corn Eyes family, mom and auntie, two sisters, a little brother. He had no other jobs except for the one at the school, but that was volunteer work since he didn't have a degree. But he liked kids, so he did it anyway. He couldn't move to the city because even if he could get a job, there'd still be nobody here to take care of the family, which meant Thomas was never getting out of this place. He leaned on the counter now and stared out the window. He did that a lot. The prickly pear had shifted again since the woman had driven off in her caddy. That made him think of her raven aura. And that made him think about this ability he had to see into the spirit world. Maybe he should go talk to Ramon Morago. For all he knew, a shaman's apprentice got a salary, though if he committed to studying with the shaman, he knew he'd really never get out of here. The doves and quail out in the parking lot scattered suddenly as Reuben's pickup pulled in, dragging a cloud of dust behind it. It was early October and the rains would be coming soon, but right now the land was bone dry. You couldn't even walk without kicking up dust. Thomas went out to help Reuben unload.
"What are you doing this weekend?" Reuben asked, as they brought the last load of dry goods and dairy inside.
Thomas shrugged. "I promised my sisters I'd take them to some thrift shops in the city if Ben will lend me his truck.
You can borrow mine if he's using his."
Thomas's spirits lifted a little. He loved driving Reuben's pickup. Taking it all the way to Santo del Vado Viejo would be a fun adventure for a change. "Thanks." They busied themselves restocking the shelves and cooler.
"There's going to be a sweat on Saturday," Reuben said. "Over by Aggie's place, you should come."
Thomas shook his head. "Now, you know I don't do stuff like that." Reuben regarded him for a long moment, then just shook his head.
"Sometimes I can't figure you out," he said.
"What's that supposed to mean?"
"You come from one of the most traditional families on the res. You know your Aunt Lucy was Morago's spiritual advisor, right?"
Thomas shook his head. Lucy was Auntie's sister. They were both his mother's aunts, not his, and he didn't know much about her since she died when he was still a little kid. He knew her sister, Layla, whom everybody just called Auntie, better, but not by much. Layla had turned 98 this past summer and spent her days sitting on the porch looking at the mountains. She told stories and handed out advice whether it was asked for or not, but she never talked about herself.
"I didn't think women could be shamans," he said. "They don't have to be. Women's magic is more powerful than our people, always has been."
Thomas just looked at him.
"You're a good kid," Reuben said. "You're responsible. You take care of your family. You help out at the school, but sometimes I get the feeling you're embarrassed about being a kikami."
"You think I should be running out in the desert with your dog boys?" Reuben waved that off.
"I get it's not for everybody. Some of us run in a pack, some are lone wolves. Whatever turns your crank. I'm just curious as to why you don't want anything to do with our traditions.
He held up a hand before Thomas could even think about how to respond. But if you want to tell me to mind my own business, that's fine, no hard feelings.
Thomas sighed. You wouldn't understand. Try me.
Thomas put a last bag of sugar on the shelf and stood up. He looked out the window to the dusty parking lot, the scrub brush on the other side of the road, the foothills, the mountains rising up behind them. Finally, he turned back to Reuben.
I feel trapped here, he said. There's more to the world than these dry hills and dust, but I feel like I'm never going to see it.
Because you have to take care of your family.
Thomas nodded.
That? And no offense, because I appreciate this job, but there's no way I can put enough aside working here to get a traveling stake. I'm stuck in this place.
Reuben laughed, but he stopped right away when Thomas began to bristle.
You think you're the only one to feel that way?
Reuben asked.
I left the res when I was 16 and spent the next 10 years seeing the world until I realized the thing I was looking for was right here.
You?
But you're, warrior society, out beating the drum for all our traditions to anyone who will listen. But once upon a time, I was a punk whose only dream was to get as far away as I could from here.
Thomas didn't know what to say.
I wouldn't even be telling you all of this, Reuben went on, except I know you're not like a lot of kids. You've got something in here.
He brought a closed fist up against his chest,
a connection to this place, to the spirits. And I guess I just want to tell you that you don't have to be afraid of it. Embrace that connection, even just to try it on for size. You could surprise yourself. You could fall in love with this place, the same as me. And if nothing happens, or you don't like what you're feeling, he shrugged, well, you can still just walk away from it all.
Thomas returned his gaze to the stark landscape beyond the window pane. It was weird how Reuben's words echoed those of the woman with the raven aura.
Except I don't want to be a shaman, he said.
He glanced at Reuben, who raised his eyebrows.
Who says you have to be?
Reuben asked when Thomas didn't go on. Thomas cleared his throat.
You see those cacti out there?
The prickly pear?
Thomas nodded.
Every morning when I come here, they're in a different position.
Yeah, Reuben said. Those prickly pear boys don't try all that hard to go unnoticed.
Seriously? Thomas said. That's all you've got to say?
What am I supposed to say? I know you see things other people don't. I watch your eyes track things only people like you and I see.
Exactly.
Reuben gave him a puzzled look.
I'm not following. What's your point?
Kikami who sees stuff like that end up as shaman. Or one of your dog boys.
Reuben smiled.
Well, at least you don't go through life in denial like Steve Cole.
The old desert rat?
He's not that old.
Come on, he might be even older than you.
Reuben's smile widened and he shook his head.
Some parts of being 18, I forget.
Okay, so neither of you is old. But what about Cole?
Thomas asked.
He's been living outside of the world for the past 40 years, and he doesn't even know it.
You mean he sees stuff, too?
You bet.
But mostly, he just takes it in and carries on as though everything's normal. He doesn't even realize how special that spot is where he's camped.
But he's not even kicking me. You don't have to be kicking me to see spirits or to walk in their lands.
I didn't know that.
Sounds like there's a lot you don't know.
Thomas's voice trailed off. He took a steadying breath.
So, what time does this sweat start? He finally asked.
Chapter 5. Steve. I think about my conversation with Aggie as I follow the ridge trail from her place down into the res and finally to the Painted Lands Community Center, which also houses both the school and Morago's office. The whole time I'm walking, I can't get one comment out of my head. Be careful. Fox girls are tricksters. What the hell's that supposed to mean? I can't see any reason why Aggie'd go warning me about calico. It throws me a bit. Then I remember she added that antelope are loyal, so I'm probably okay. I hope she's right. I have to admit that when calico first showed up, I thought I was having some crazy LSD flashback. Even having heard plenty of campfire stories on the res about Ma'inawa, or cousins, it took me a while to accept not only Calico's presence, but how she took such a personal interest in me. Personal is an understatement. That girlfriend of mine's horny as a jackrabbit and not the least bit shy to let you know about it. She's another piece of the beauty of this wild land, and I love it all the more for her part in it. I just wanted to hold on to our privacy. Sadie spouted off to Aggie, but I hope it doesn't go any further. Like any small place, people on the res love nothing more than to toss around some juicy gossip, so it travels fast. The community center is a long, low adobe building. It looks like every time they needed more space, they just added another few rooms on, which is exactly the case. Mesquite and Palo Verde cluster near the walls, with one old uncle saguaro and the usual mess of prickly pear and brush. I pause at the glass front doors and try to clear my head before I go inside. Janet's at the front desk, looking at something on her computer screen. Hola, Steve, she says. Hey, Janet, is Morago in? Are you kidding? She says. Sometimes I think he lives in that office of his. There's nobody with him right now. Thanks. I can hear kids playing in the gym as I follow the hall to Morago's office. He's the tribal shaman, but he also runs the whole center and the dorm down the road where the kids who don't have homes live. It's mostly other tribes in the dorm. Yaqui, Apache, Tohono, Adam, with a handful of Mexican kids who lost their parents crossing the desert and don't have families on this side of the border. They're supposed to be sent back, but Morago's got a way of bending the rules if it's better for the kid. He's on the phone when I step into his office and he waves me to a chair. The furniture's all mission style, solid and dependable, softened with pillows and rugs and bright kikimi patterns. It feels more like a traditional home than an office, if you ignore the modern office gear. Computer, printer, fancy phone. Morago's pure-blooded kikimi, but he doesn't look it. Where most of the tribe members have wide faces and carry some weight, he's lean with piercing amber eyes and narrow chiseled features, and his dark hair is a deep russet color. I remember asking him about it once, and he said he thought a few generations back, one of his ancestors was probably a red-tailed hawk. I laughed at the time. Now, thinking about Aggie's comment about cousins stopping in for a visit, and I'm not so sure anymore. Morago finishes up his conversation with an hola and hangs up. In Kikimi, hola means both hello and goodbye. I get an hola, too, then he asks, And how are you today, he who walks with the moonlight? Feeling stupid, and stop trying to give me one of your phony made-up Indian names. Every time I see him, he's got a new one for me. My favorite is, pisses like a horse. Is it my fault I've got a big bladder? Feeling stupid's a good way to start a journey into wisdom, he says. No, it's just because of something Aggie told me.
that some of the people I meet out in the hills aren't necessarily human. Morago smiles.
And you're only figuring that out now?
Jesus, don't you start.
Morago spreads his hands. The world is what it is.
He waits a beat before adding,
Is that what you came to talk to me about?
I shake my head.
Then it must be about the white girl you left at Aggie's place.
How the hell could you know about that?
He nods to the window.
On the other side of the glass, a couple of crows are perched on a low-hanging branch of a mesquite tree that's almost touching the pane.
The crows were gossiping about it, he says.
Aggie's got me so rattled that I can't tell if he's joking or not. He's always coming out with crap like that. The difference now is I'm actually wondering if it's true. I decide to ignore it and tell him what I know about Sadie.
You sure it's a good idea?
He asks when I'm done.
The kids are all getting along right now, but they still hang out with their own tribe or race. She'll be the only white kid.
Aggie says it's okay for Sadie to stay at her place for now.
Okay. And you're sure she's serious about studying? We've only just gotten Olivia to stop acting out. I don't know that we need another source of disruption right now.
Maybe you could have a talk with her. Judge the situation for yourself. I mean, she's got nothing to go back to.
Yeah, but is anybody going to come looking for her?
He asks. What do you think? Her old man threw her away like garbage. Morago sighs.
The problem is lots of people throw things away and then decide later they want to keep them after all.
Sadie's a person, not a thing.
I know that. It's just that the Indian and Mexican kids, we can be sure nobody's coming for them. Their parents are dead, or in jail, or meth heads who can't string a couple of thoughts together. Sadie's father sounds like a monster, but he's still in the picture, as it were. Trouble starts with her. It could blow back on everybody.
Just tell me you'll talk to her and think about it. That's all I ask.
Of course, I'll talk to her. Hell, if you really want her in, just say the word.
I shake my head. When we started this, I said no strings attached. You're the guy in charge.
Sure, but we can't go down that road, I tell him.
She either gets in on her own merit and yours say so, or I start looking for other options. I stand up. And I'll know if you're bullshitting me.
You always do. You heading home?
Aunt Nora puts on a great spread for the kids. You could eat with us. No, I need to get back to my place and think about all of this. I'm about to turn away, except Morago's holding my gaze, and I find I can't look away.
Don't look at this new knowledge as something that's going to mess up your life. Look at it as finding a deeper understanding of the world you're living in.
What's that supposed to mean?
Instead of answering, he asks, You're going home by the ridge trail?
I nod.
Do me a favor when you get back to the trailer. Pull out a map and measure the distance from here to Painted Cloud Canyon.
I know how far it is. I've walked it 1,000 times. It takes me about an hour.
He nods. I know. But humor me. Look at the map when you get back.
You don't have to do the cryptic shaman crap with me.
I'm not. But if you have any questions later, you know where to find me.
I am so not enjoying this day. Fine, I tell him. He smiles.
Hola, brother.
He's got a smile you can't resist. No matter what's going on, how pissed off you might be about something, or how bummed, you can't help but respond. I'm still grinning when I give Janet a goodbye wave and head out the front door of the community center. Once I'm climbing up into the foothills behind the res, I decide to time myself. I get a reading from the sun and start walking. It's steep going until I reach the ridge trail.
The sky is cloudless and the sun is unrelenting. I pick up a trio of turkey buzzards once I'm on the trail, all three drifting in lazy circles high above me as I head north. I wish I were up there with them. The heat bouncing off the rocks and dirt make it twice as hot down here as where they are. We didn't have our usual furnace of a summer, but the fall's been making up for it with day after day of unseasonably hot weather. Usually the rains have come by now, cooling everything down, but we haven't had any water since the spring monsoons. I keep to a steady pace. It gives me plenty of time to think. I don't know what Morago's game is. Possum showed me this trail back when we first met, and like I told Morago, I've been walking it ever since. I know every foot of it, every view. I don't see how tracing it out on a map is going to tell me something I don't already know. But Morago's always been there for me and Possum. He's seen us through a lot of crap. Hell, I've probably known him longer than I have anybody else I can think of, on or off the res, because we go back to long before I got to the Painted Hills. So I'll give him the benefit of the doubt and accept that he's got a good reason for this strange request. When I get to the turnoff to my place, the position of the sun tells me it's taken me an hour and a bit, more or less, just as it always does. The new trail winds between walls of rock until it deposits me into the hollow behind my trailer. From where I stand, there's just a short cave length to the ledge where the trailer sits. This hollow's an odd little place, no bigger than a decent-sized backyard, and it doesn't matter how hot or cold it is in the canyon itself or out on the mountain ridge trails, the temperature in here always seems moderate. It's like it has its own little microclimate. There's a spring-fed pool at one end, shaded by a pair of sycamores. The other end gets all the sun, and that's where Possum set up the garden I still maintain. I've got corn growing there, carrots, peas, peppers, beans, all kinds of squash. On a raised bed to one side, there's a selection of herbs. Behind the trees and between the pool and the rock face is a tall gap in the rock that gives an overview of the valley. Years back, before I knew him, Possum set up a wooden bench there to watch the sunset, and I still come up to do the same thing. I like to watch the moonlight, too. Full moon especially, when the shadows grow across the desert floor and it feels like you're looking out on some whole other world. I'd like to settle down on the bench for a while right now, but I'm too curious about Morago's mysterious request. So I leave the hollow to walk down a short natural stone stairway, past the cistern, and into the cave. A few moments later, I emerge on the ledge where the trailer sits. Damned if I know how Possum got it up here. He'd have to have had it hoisted up with a crane, because the bottom of the canyon's a good 10 feet down from the lip of the ledge, and the trailer's a full-sized airstream. An overhang keeps the worst of the sun off of it, and there's room between the trailer and the edge for a picnic table and fire pit. Everything in the trailer runs on propane. When I need a new tank, Reuben Littletree delivers it by ATV, though we have to haul it up by hand from the canyon floor. But the damnedest thing of all is how people climbing up the canyon just never notice the trailer. I can be sitting on the picnic table playing my guitar, and they don't even look once in my direction. When I asked Possum about it, he just shrugged and said something about how sound doesn't always carry the way you'd think it would in these mountains, and the trailer was just at the wrong angle to be seen from below. Except I've been down there looking up and had no trouble spotting it. Truth is, I'd be hard-pressed to ignore that big shiny tube on wheels sitting on a ledge where it has no godly right to be. I go into the airstream and grab a bottled water from the fridge, then pull out a roll of maps from where they're wedged in between the bookcase and the wall. Outside, I find the one I'm looking for and spread it open on the picnic table. Holding the corners down with stones, I use my finger to trace the distance from the res to the trail that took me into the hollow. Son of a
bitch. That can't be right.
Frowning, I retrace the route, but even careful measurement doesn't change a damn thing. I decide to change tack. I find the spot where Sadie's father dumped her in the desert and follow the route we hiked to the ride trail into the res. We walked about 3 hours, and that's pretty much what the map tells me it should have taken. So what gives with my route back to the trailer? If the map's to be believed, it should also have taken me 3 hours to get here, three times as long as it actually did. Somebody's messing with me. I'd blame it on the map, except I bought it myself and I know it's accurate. I just never traced this particular route on it before. So that leaves Morago. But why the hell would he trick me?
What you doing?
I almost drop my water bottle at the sound of Calico's voice. She saunters from the cave and drops down on the bench across from me. A bushy tail swishes behind her, stirring up dust. She's got a teasing smile that reaches all the way up to her eyes. So I guess I'm not all that bright, I say. She cocks an eyebrow. I mean, Aggie tells me some of the other people I've met out here are ma'inoa, like you.
That's true, she says. But why would it bother you?
How do I even know what's real and what isn't?
Do you want a practical answer or a philosophical one?
I sigh. Just one I can understand.
And when you put it like that, she says, do you really mean you want to understand or that you want to believe?
Both, I suppose.
That's not easy. For 40-some years, you've already proved yourself plenty obstinate about ignoring what's right in front of your face.
I rub my face. Maybe I'm having a flashback.
See, there you go again. That's what you thought I was until I did some pretty convincing things to prove otherwise.
She gives me a knowing smile. I reach across the table and run a finger down the short curve of one of her horns, like I have 100 times before. No, I've never been imagining her, but I've never questioned the mystery of her either. So, what are you? I ask.
What did I tell you the first time we met?
You said you were ma'inoa, that your mother's deer, father's fox.
That's still true.
But ma'inoa's not a tribal name. It's kikimi for cousin.
Still true, she says. That's what the animal tribes call each other, cousins.
So, what? A deer and a fox made out and had a little girl they called Calico?
Pretty much.
How's that even physically possible? She laughs.
Well, they weren't in their animal shapes, that's for sure.
So your parents can look like humans or animals? She nods. And you look the way you do because your parents were different kinds of animals?
You mean this?
She says, touching a horn. Then an ear. I nod. She laughs again.
No, I just look like this to mess with you. I figured sooner or later you'd realize that what you see is really what you get. But it turned out to be a lot later than I ever thought.
My throat's way too dry and I'm feeling a touch of vertigo. So, I pause to clear my throat, then gulp a slug of water. What do you really look like?
Like this, she says. What you see. Or, like this.
Suddenly, instead of the foxalope girl leaning toward me with her elbows on the picnic table, she becomes a pointy-faced fox, dark-eyed gaze fixed on mine. Then the fox is gone, and a small antelope stands on the tabletop and seat, like she's perched on the red rocks of the canyon.
Or like this, she says.
Finally, she's Calico again. Except now she looks completely human. No horns, no fox ears, no tail. I close my eyes and lay my head on the table, my cheek pressed into the map. I'm losing my fucking mind.
What makes you say that? She asks.
Well, it's either that or I've been living a lie, I say.
None of it's a lie. Cousins can't lie, so I'm telling you the truth. You need to take the world out of the box you put it in and accept it for what it is, not what you want it to be.
I open an eye to look at her. Really, I say. My life goes batshit, and that's your advice? She looks puzzled.
Batshit?
I sit up and jab a finger on the map. What about this? I ask. The fact it takes me an hour and a bit to walk, which should be a 3-hour hike if you go by the map.
Oh, this place. That's another story, a long one.
I've got the time. She cocks her head.
You know, Possum took all of this a lot better than you.
Was he your lover before me? She smiles.
No. He hooked up with my aunt, on my mother's side, the antelope side.
I lay my head back down on the map and let out a groan.
Okay,
she says, brushing her hand along my cheek for a moment.
Apparently you're not. Taking it well, I mean.
She rests her chin on her hands so that our faces are only inches apart.
Possum first showed up here in the early 1900s, she says. I guess he must have been in his early 20s.
The rational part of my brain does the math, but I don't call her on how impossibly old that would have made him. I just let her words wash over me and try as hard as I can to keep an open mind.
Chapter 6. Sadie. Sadie sat and stared at Aggie's computer screen, trying to process what she'd discovered. It hadn't been hard to find news stories about Steve's grandmother. She hadn't even needed the woman's surname because there'd never exactly been a rash of women named Sadie in Texas who'd gotten the death penalty for murdering their husbands. What she hadn't expected was how easy it would be to find out Steve's full name and why he was hiding out here in the mountains. Make that Steve's real name. Jackson Cole. Stephen was only his middle name. The big news was that he just happened to have been the lead singer of the Diesel Rats, as well as their principal songwriter and guitarist, who died in a plane crash over the Atlantic 20 years ago, but his body had never been recovered. Of course it wouldn't have been recovered, Sadie thought, because he'd never died. Instead, he was living here in the middle of nowhere. Add on a few years, and the pictures she found online looked exactly like younger versions of the man she'd met after Reggie booted her out of his car. Why would he hide his identity? Better yet, what the hell was he doing here? If he needed to get away, shouldn't he be kicking it back on some tropical beach? If she had his kind of money, she'd be living high on the hog. She'd have the best of everything. Mansions and a private jet and fabulous gowns and jewelry. All the things that super rich people had. And he had to have been rich, because the Diesel Rats were mega huge in their day. Still were, even if their singer had died and they hadn't made a new recording in 40 years. They'd sold hundreds of millions of records worldwide, like Michael Jackson numbers. Even she'd heard their music before, and not just the famously sampled riff from Burning Heart that helped DJ Crash take his Don't You Mess With Me to number one last year. You couldn't turn on an oldie station without hearing something by the Rats over the course of a couple of hours. Gimme, 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 Jenny Don't You Cry, Stars Are Falling. And every Christmas, there seemed to be a couple of new covers of Peace Will Come, We Can Make It Happen. Maybe he took off because the press at the time wouldn't let go of the fact his grandmother was a murderer, that she was one of only 5 women who'd been executed in Texas since the 70s. But really, how big an impact would something like that have made on his life in those days? They didn't even have the internet, so it wasn't like it would go viral. Though if back then was anything like now, she supposed the press would still have been all over him, especially since that hadn't been the only thing to go wrong.
Not long after Cole's grandmother was executed, Sully, full name Frank Sullivan, according to Wikipedia, Steve's best friend since childhood and the bass player in the band, was found dead of an overdose in his hotel room. Before the autopsy report could be delivered, Cole and his drummer Martin Getty had a huge falling out over whether or not the band should get a new bass player and continue. Cole wanted some time. Getty insisted they should finish the 20 dates left on their tour. Getty had stormed out of the hotel where they were staying and died in a car crash an hour later, speeding on the interstate. Cole's longtime girlfriend, Toni Shaw, chose that same period of time to walk out on him, citing that their relationship had become toxic. Later, she tried suing him for division of property, claiming she'd supported him through the hard times when the band was just getting started. It went to court, where it was revealed she'd been having an affair with the band's business manager. Cole went from rock and roll megastar to poster boy for tragedy, especially after he died as well. Sadie found link after link to articles about the band and their music, and the mystery death of Jackson Cole. It was music nerd city out there in the blogosphere. It was stupid how much was still being written about the band, which, she realized, probably meant that proof he was still alive would be worth big bucks to somebody. God, how much? 10 grand, 20? Lots, she was sure. Except, who could you trust? One of the gossip sites, or maybe a tabloid, but who was to say they wouldn't stiff you? There were lots of books on the band as well, and one name kept popping up in the reviews about them, Leah Hardin. She'd apparently written the definitive biography on Cole, as well as a whole bunch of other books on the band, their humble beginnings, how they handled fame, their influence. She even had a book that chronicled every recording session they'd ever done, which just seemed like overkill, as well as one that reviewed every bootleg. And if that wasn't enough, she also had a blog named after the band's third album, Rats on the Run, which she seemed to update at least every week. Hello, Leah. Get a life or what? What could possibly be left to say? But that very fanaticism of hers might make her the best person to contact. The woman would at least get another book out of it. Hell, with the amount of words she seemed able to churn out on every stupid detail of the band's life, she could probably get 3 or 4. There was an email contact link on the blog. Sadie clicked on it and composed her message. She thought for a moment before sending it, then used the camera on the laptop to take a picture of Aggie's painting of Steve. She attached it to the email before pressing send. Clearing the browser cache, she shut down the laptop. When she stood up, the red dog got up as well. I'm gonna be rich, Ruby, she told it. What do you think about that? The dog just stared at her. Sadie had too much of a buzz on to stay cooped up inside. She went out to walk around Aggie's property, the dog following on her heels. Chapter 7. Thomas. It was just past closing time, and Thomas was giving the store a final sweep when Reuben clapped him on the shoulder. Hey, Thomas, can you make some deliveries on your way home? I guess. Great. You can just keep the truck until I see you at Aggie's tomorrow night. Thomas grinned. Getting to keep the truck the whole next day would make the extra time worth it. Reuben helped him load the deliveries. Thomas groaned when he saw the tall propane cylinder already strapped to the trading post's ATV, which was tied in place in the back of the pickup. He'd never made a delivery to Steve Cole's place. Reuben usually handled that. Really? He said. You want me to drive all the way out to Painted Cloud Canyon? Reuben smiled. What's it going to take? 40 minutes each way if you don't speed too much. Another 20 to unload and get up to Cole's place. I don't even know where Cole's trailer is in the canyon. Trust me, you can't miss it.
and I know how you love to drive my truck. It was a sweet ride, no question. A 56 Chevy with a rebuilt engine that rumbled like a big old bear. The shocks were so good, you barely felt the washboard bumps on the Rez's worst roads, and it had pickup to spare. Just don't get a ticket, Reuben added. Like the cops are ever out on Zara Road. Reuben gave him a look. Okay, Thomas assured him, I won't speed. Much. That's what I wanted to hear. Reuben got into the passenger side. You can drop me off at the community center on your way to Auntie Susan's. Thomas looked at the list Reuben had given him. Susan Many Deer's name was at the top of the list. No problem. On his way back to the highway after making all the deliveries in the res, Thomas spotted his sister, Santana, sitting on a fence with a couple of her friends. He slowed down and honked at her. The girls started to give him the finger until they saw who it was, then Santana waved him down. When he came to a stop, she trotted over and leaned her forearms in the window on the passenger side. Are we taking Reuben's truck to town tomorrow? She asked. He nodded. Sweet. Where are you going now? Out Zara Road to Painted Cloud. Can I come? So long as you call Mom first to tell her where you're going. Santana grinned. She waved to her friends, got in, and thumbed their home number on her phone. Hey, Naya, she said to their sister when the connection was made. Can you tell Mom I'm making a delivery with Thomas, and we'll both be back when it's done? Seatbelt, Thomas said. Santana stuck out her tongue, but she used her free hand to buckle up. Mom wants to know how long we'll be, she said. Under 2 hours, but not by much. 2 hours, she said into the phone. We're going to Painted Cloud. She listened for a moment, then rolled her eyes. Mom says to be careful, she told Thomas, because that's a place where the deer women like to pick up unsuspecting suitors. Thomas sighed. Tell her we'll be careful. Thomas says he doesn't believe in deer women, she said into the phone. Santana, but we'll be especially careful all the same. She laughed at something Naya said, then hung up. Why do you have to wind Mom up? Thomas said. Because we're not living in the 1800s anymore. She leaned back and stretched out her arms along the back of the seat. God, I love this truck, she said. Someday I'm going to have one just like it. I'll pull up at the powwows and the boys will all say, isn't she fine? And they'll like the truck, too. Thomas laughed. Powwows were the one thing he'd really miss about the res if he ever got away. Both Santana and Naya were jingle dancers, and he never missed a chance to see them perform. Powwows were also the only time that everybody got along, the traditionalists and the casino crowd. He thought of going to talk to Sammy Swiftgrass at the casino and try to get a job where he could make some real money, but Auntie and his mother would have disowned him. He wasn't the only one who enjoyed seeing the girls dance at the powwows. He'd heard more than one guy already say, isn't she fine, while they watched Santana. She was 17, almost a woman, so he made a big brother note of who they were for future reference and let it slide. But no one got to talk that way about Naya. She was only 15, with a lot of growing still to do, and he was here to make sure she wouldn't have anyone hassling her. Listening to the wheels hum on the asphalt, he had to agree with Santana about liking the truck. The interior of the Chev had been restored with the same painstaking care as the rest of it. Reuben and his nephew, Jack Youngdeer, had done most of the work. What they hadn't been able to handle themselves, Reuben had gotten done in town at Sanchez Motorworks. Thomas could still remember the big grin on Reuben's face when he finally sold off his Jeep and the Chev became his main ride. Of course, now he was already working on another old junker. If you think this truck looks good, he told his sister, you just try driving it. She sat up and gave him an eager look. can I?
Only if the dear women steal me away.
She collapsed back against her seat. Now I'm actually hoping they do show up and take you with them.
They drove on for a while without talking. Thomas enjoyed the feel of the ride, while Santana fiddled with the radio dial until she came up with some music she liked. Naturally, she chose Mexican rap. Not his favorite, but he found himself bobbing his head along with the beat all the same. Halfway to Painted Cloud Canyon, Santana turned the radio down.
"Do you believe any of that stuff Auntie and Mom talk about?" she asked.
He thought about the conversation he'd had earlier with Reuben. This seemed to be the day for it.
"Yeah, I guess I do. I've seen things."
There, it was out. He glanced at Santana to find her looking relieved.
"Really? Because, you know, sometimes I think I see things that aren't really there, or at least nobody else seems to see them. I never talk about it because I don't want people to think I'm crazy."
"It runs in our family, apparently," he said. "Reuben told me today that our Aunt Lucy is the one who taught Ramon Morago to be a shaman."
"Shut up! Are you bullshitting me?"
He shook his head.
"So how come you don't talk about it?" she asked. "Auntie and Mom would love it."
"You just answered your own question. I've already had to argue with them about not joining the dog boys."
"I like the dog boys. You would."
She elbowed him in the side but laughed.
"If they knew about this," he went on, "they'd probably force me to go to Morago as an apprentice. Would that be so bad? I want to get away. Not today, but maybe someday. If I sign on with Morago, I can't even pretend that'll ever happen."
Santana nodded.
"Yeah. I wonder all the time what it'd be like to live like the rest of the world does."
They were coming up on the parking lot for the Painted Cloud Canyon trailhead. Thomas pulled in, maneuvering the truck so the tailgate was pointing at the trail. He turned the engine off, and they got out.
"Have you been out here before?"
Santana asked. Thomas shook his head. "Reuben just told me to go up the canyon, and I wouldn't miss it."
"Huh. We're off the res now, right?"
"Yeah. This is all national parkland."
"I didn't think people could live on national parkland."
"I don't know what the story is," Thomas said. Santana helped him to get the ramp on, and he drove the ATV off the truck. Once he had it on the ground, he checked to make sure the big propane tank was securely strapped in place. Satisfied, he turned to his sister.
"You want to come or wait here?" he asked.
"You're kidding, right?" he grinned. "Hop on." Chapter 8. Sadie. Sadie found Aggie sitting on a bench outside her studio. The handful of dogs sleeping around her feet roused when Sadie and Ruby approached. Sadie froze as the pack surrounded her, sniffing and pushing their shoulders up against her legs.
"Leave her be," Aggie said in a mild voice. "She lives here now."
The dogs immediately lost interest in Sadie and went back to sprawling in the dirt or on the porch where Aggie was sitting.
"I thought you were painting," Sadie said, as she took a seat beside the old woman. "I am. Right now I'm considering colors. I usually do it on my palette, but sometimes I'd like to sit out here and do it in my head instead."
Sadie nodded as if she understood. Aggie waved a hand to take in the view.
"And of course, having all of this for inspiration doesn't hurt. There's a reason our ancestors called this the Painted Lands."
Sadie looked out across the foothills. Santo del Vado Viejo was a hazy smudge in the distance, hard to see because of the lowering sun. She didn't see any painted lands. All she saw was dull scrub and desert.
"I've never spent much time outdoors," Sadie said. "I mean, in a place like this." "I've never spent much time in the city," Aggie told her.
so I can't really compare the two, but I'm pretty sure I know which one I prefer.
Sadie did too, and she knew Aggie's choice wouldn't be her own. If she could get some money out of that Leah Hardin woman, she'd be so out of here.
I've found out why Steve's been living here on the down low, she said. I know all about who he was.
Aggie regarded her for a moment, then returned her attention to the view.
Don't you want to hear what I found out? Sadie asked.
Aggie shook her head.
Just because you know who someone was doesn't make any difference in terms of who they are now.
What's that supposed to mean?
It means I know everything about Steve that I need to know.
Sadie thought about how pretty much all you wanted to know about anything was available with only a few clicks of a mouse.
The world doesn't work like that anymore, she said. Mine does.
Sadie resisted a retort. Aggie hadn't used the tone that Reggie did, meaning one more wrong word and you'd get a smack across the head. She didn't even think Aggie could ever smack somebody across the head. But there was a finality in her tone that made it clear the conversation was over.
Be like that, Sadie thought. If I make any money, I won't share it with you.
You need to understand, Aggie finally said. You're underage. We shouldn't be letting you stay here. If your parents come after you, we could be in a lot of trouble.
My parents won't come after me. My old man threw me out, remember?
Aggie nodded.
It's just, Steve did you a favor. He's still doing you a favor, setting you up at the school and all. Don't repay him by digging into his past. If he wants you to know about it, he'll tell you.
Okay, Sadie said. I get it.
The old woman stood up.
It's time we fed the dogs and made ourselves some dinner. Do you want to help?
I don't know anything about cooking.
Then I'll teach you.
Sadie bit back another retort and found a smile to put on her face. The old woman was right about some things. She did owe Aggie and Steve for helping her out, and she didn't have anywhere to go. She stood up as well.
I'd like that, she lied.
Chapter 9. Thomas. The trail was broad with plenty of room for the ATV. From the trailhead, their route took a wide series of switchbacks through the desert, straightening when it reached the canyon. The red limestone rose taller on each side of them. In only a few minutes of driving, they'd become cliffs, and Santana tapped Thomas on the shoulder, pointing. Thomas nodded. He'd already seen it. A big silver trailer up on a ledge, gleaming in the light of the lowering sun. How the hell had anybody gotten something that big up there? He killed the engine of the ATV, and the two of them got off. In the sudden silence, they could hear a couple of guitars playing. One played a droning rhythm that sounded like the drumbeat of a powwow round dance, while the other played the chorus of voices that would normally have added to the drums. Santana smiled.
That is so cool, she said.
Thomas nodded, but he was more concerned about how they were going to get the tank up the narrow little path that he could see going up to the ledge. Reuben hadn't mentioned anything like this. He turned to his sister.
Let's go see if somebody up there knows how we can make this delivery without killing ourselves.
Santana nodded.
And check out the musicians.
But when they got up onto the ledge, they discovered it was only Steve up there playing both parts on the guitar. He seemed so lost in the music that he didn't notice their arrival. So they stood and listened until he suddenly became aware of their presence.
Thomas! Steve said. He looked a little startled. What are you doing here?
Hola, I'm bringing you your propane.
And you could see, well, obviously you could see the trailer.
Kind of hard to miss, Steve nodded.
except most people don't see it because apparently it only exists in magic land. Thomas shrugged. He didn't know Steve Cole all that well. Reuben usually dealt with him. But even with the little he knew of him, he thought the man was acting a bit strange. How could he possibly think that anybody wouldn't notice that big airstream and possibly set way up on this ledge? And what was magic land? This is my sister, Santana, he said. Steve lifted a hand in greeting. Hola, Santana said. I loved what you were doing with that round dance. It sounded like a couple of guitars playing instead of just one. He shrugged. It's just an open tuning, he said, as though that explained everything. Thomas looked around. This was a pretty sweet spot with a great view going down the canyon and out onto the desert floor. The overhang above the trailer would protect it from the worst of the sun, though it didn't feel particularly hot, even where he and Santana were standing. There seemed to be a cave opening beside the trailer, but from the light coming through, he figured it must be an arch. The landscape in this area was riddled with them. How'd this trailer get up here? He asked. Damned if I know, Steve said. This was Possum's place originally, and the secret died with him. He set the guitar aside. I guess we need to wrestle that tank up. You want to take the empty down first? Thomas regarded him for a moment. Steve was fit, especially considering his age.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.